Welcome, I'm Catherine Hadro, and this is EWTN Pro-Life Weekly.
We can't let our campus clinics become abortion clinics.
Keeping campuses safe. U.S. Senator Steve Daines of Montana introduces a new bill banning federal funds from going towards colleges and universities that perform abortions or provide abortion pills. He joins us from Capitol Hill. Overturn Roe. Mississippi's attorney general asks the Supreme Court to overturn Roe versus Wade, what this means for the pro-life movement. The rights of women. In her new book, a Catholic legal scholar delves into the development and evolution of the feminist movement in the United States. She shares how the false idea of abortion as a women's right originated. And it's Natural Family Planning Awareness Week. An OBGYN and NaProTechnology surgeon explains the medical advantage to embracing NFP methods and saying no to hormonal contraception. Hear how NFP truly empowers women's health. The chair of the Senate's pro-life caucus has introduced a new bill to bar federal funds from going to public colleges and universities that provide abortions.
Never forget that when our founding fathers laid out the Declaration of Independence, they talked about life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And you can't have liberty and the pursuit of happiness without first having that inalienable right given by God, and that is the right to life. It is time for Congress to pass this life-saving bill.
That was Senator Steve Daines of Montana last week introducing what's being called a landmark piece of pro-life legislation. The bill, known as the Protecting Life on College Campus Act, would stop the federal funding of public colleges and universities that offer abortions or abortion pills at campus health clinics. Daines, who founded the Senate Pro-Life Caucus, said these do-it-yourself abortions put young women in dangerous situations that they are oftentimes forced to deal with alone in their dorm room. Joining us now from Capitol Hill is Senator Steve Daines of Montana, chair of the Senate Pro-Life Caucus. Senator Daines, welcome back. Can you first explain what do we know about the reality of chemical abortions happening on our college campuses?
Well, it's just heartbreaking. And I speak as not just a U.S. senator, but as a father of four. We have two boys and two girls. We are grandparents now of two. Our oldest daughter, Annie, is pregnant. We expect another grandbaby in December. And you know, when the psalmist wrote that we are fearfully and wonderfully made, when you start looking at these apps you can get online that show the development of these little babies in the womb, it's just absolutely a miracle. And yet here we have a state like California that's going to require these abortion pills to be distributed to all campuses in the next few years. This is very, very dangerous. Of course, first and foremost, the little babies, to kill these little babies. But second, to the young women. About 7% of women who take one of these abortion pills requires some kind of surgery. So this is a very dangerous and reckless move by the state of California. And what my bill does is it says, if you provide these kind of resources, these abortion pills, to college campuses, the federal government will cut off their funding to these universities.
Wow, that is so important. Senator, do you think you can garner enough support for the bill? And what about support from your Democrat colleagues?
Yeah, well, as you know, we are always going to keep fighting for those who can't express their own voice here on Capitol Hill, and that is the unborn. It's always going to be a challenge, sadly, with my Democrat colleagues who increasingly are just hostile to pro-life legislation. But that's not going to stop us from sitting down and having a common sense conversation about we're here to protect the lives of these little babies. We're here to protect the lives of young women. With these abortion pills, it's very, very dangerous. So we just need to have all listeners make sure that they are writing in and calling in to their members of Congress and the members of the U.S. Senate to support this bill.
Absolutely. And it seems that the abortion industry, in fact, targets college women. So many abortion facilities are located near campuses.
Well, that's one of the big fights we have here on Capitol Hill is against
the pro-abortion lobby groups. These are big money making operations. I mean, how tragic, how sad to think they are making huge amounts of money and profits by killing little babies. And so we've got to get this message out. And I think parents might be shocked to know that their young women who are on the campuses, the universities, would have complete access to these abortion pills starting in California. And you know what happens sometimes in California can spread to other states. And that's why I've introduced this bill. It's time to stop it now. And we're going to cut off their federal funding if they want to turn basically our dormitories into abortion clinics. Mm-hmm.
Well, on this topic of stopping federal funds from going to abortion, I want to ask you about the Hyde Amendment. As the Senate Pro-Life Caucus Chair, what will you do to ensure the Senate protects the Hyde Amendment? It's being battled over in the House right now.
It is. It's just, it's really sad to see President Biden and the Democrats stopping, you know, decades of precedent, which is the Hyde Amendment that says we're not going to allow federal funds to be used for abortions. The Democrats are throwing that out the window now. And I can tell you we're going to be unified as Republicans to stop this. I presented a letter to President Biden that had virtually every Republican senator saying we cannot violate the Hyde Amendment. This is going to be another fight. So we've got what we call a filibuster-proof majority on that. But the question is, if the Democrats choose to use a 50-vote kind of margin with this process called reconciliation, they can get around our ability to stop it. So again, we urge all listeners to get in touch with their members of Congress, with their senators, and tell them, please, please keep the Hyde protections in federal legislation.
Absolutely. Senator Steve Daines, chair of the Senate Pro-Life Caucus, thank you for your leadership and for your time.
Thanks, Catherine.
We strongly support this bill, and we will never stop working to expose the brutality of abortion, and we want to be there for those young women in a very vulnerable, difficult time in their life. And the answer is not chemical abortion. It's love and support in every way.
That was Marilyn Musgrave you just heard, and she joins us now in our studio. Marilyn Musgrave is a former U.S. representative for the state of Colorado, who today serves as the vice president of government affairs for the Susan B. Anthony List. It is great to see you.
Good to be here.
You were part of that press conference introducing Senator Daines' new pro-life bill. How necessary is this piece of legislation?
Well, it's very necessary because the Biden administration has exploited the pandemic to roll back safety regulations that the FDA had on these abortion pills. And the pro-abortion Democrats and their industry allies, they want to push the chemical abortion pills as much as they can. They want them through the mail, so pharmacies and every post office would become an abortion facility, and get them on college campuses, as Senator Daines said, turning that into an abortion facility. So it's very important that we have this legislation. I'm so grateful to Senator Daines and Congressman Chip Roy and Congresswoman Mary Miller and our state and federal allies for working on this to protect unborn babies, women, and girls.
Absolutely. We know that the use of chemical abortions or abortion pills have skyrocketed in recent years, and these abortions present unique dangers to the mother. Can you speak to that?
Yes, we know that chemical abortion is more dangerous than surgical abortion. There are four times the rate of complications, and when you look at the adverse effects, things like intense pain, severe bleeding, emotional and physical trauma, and even death in some cases. And these adverse reactions are underreported. So it is very tragic, very dangerous for women.
I want to get your thoughts on another pro-life topic. White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki answered what the White House's reaction is to Mississippi asking the Supreme Court to overturn Roe versus Wade. Take a listen.
Well, certainly we are supporters, the president's supporter of preserving Roe v. Wade. That is our position in terms of a legal reaction. I would point you to the Department of Justice.
Congresswoman, what is your reaction to that?
Well, the United States is one of a handful of nations that support abortion on demand up to the moment of birth. And, you know, we're in the company of North Korea, we're in the company of China, but yet when you talk to the American people, 65% say abortion in the second trimester should be illegal. And that goes up to 80% of Americans say abortion should be illegal in the third trimester. So when you think of defending this position, we have to realize, they should realize, that the American people do not support this radical policy, and they do not support candidates that go along with abortion on demand up to the moment of birth. Mm-hmm. And when you poll people, 55% of likely voters say they would support a ban at 15 weeks, same as the Mississippi law, when they find out that that unborn child has the capacity to feel pain. High percentages of people say they would support a Republican that goes along with the 15-week ban, and only 28% of likely voters say they would support a Democrat who wants no restrictions on abortion at all. So when we look at these numbers, we know that this is radical policy, that we're out of step with the American people. And by the way, when we poll or when we seek information about European countries and their restrictions on abortion, 47 out of 50 European nations have a 15-week ban or earlier on abortion. So the Mississippi law is, it's an international norm. So here we are.
That puts it into perspective that the U.S. abortion laws are, in fact, extreme on the global scale. We have about a minute left, Congresswoman, but this whole topic of Roe v. Wade came up in the White House last week because last week Mississippi's Attorney General Lynn Fitch submitted a brief ahead of her state Supreme Court case on abortion, and she made the case to overturn Roe versus Wade at the high court. How significant was that?
Well, it's a landmark moment for the movement. Everybody in the country is watching this. She made a great case for the states having a legitimate interest in regulating abortion. And she also made the case that this needs to go back to the states. Mm-hmm. She said something like, this fever on abortion can only be broken if we send it back to the states, where compromise is more likely, where agreement is more likely, and we need to send this debate back to the states where this debate can go on in a democratic fashion. It makes much more sense. The brief is brilliant. Mm-hmm. And what an exciting time to be pro-life in this country and have the hope that we have right now.
Absolutely, and thank you for bringing that hope and truth to us. Marilyn Musgrave with the Susan B. Anthony List, thank you.
So good to be with you.
Thanks. A Catholic legal scholar offers an original look at the development of feminism in the United States. In The Rights of Women, Reclaiming a Lost Vision, author Erika Bachiochi explores the development of feminist thought, including its connection to abortion in the United States. Bachiochi writes in her new book, quote, "The relentless quest for abortion rights over the last several decades has placed the modern-day women's movement squarely on the side of the individualistic and consumerist economy, ever hostile to the priorities of the child-rearing family, and so diametrically at odds with the market-resistant logic for which the women's movement originally stood." Erika Bachiochi, author of the new book, The Rights of Women, Reclaiming a Lost Vision, joins us now on Skype. Erika, welcome and congratulations on your book. First, can you give us a brief summary of your new book?
Yes, thank you, Catherine, so much for having me on. I think today many falsely assume that an unbroken line can be traced from those who today agitate for women's rights to those who argued that women had the right to do so in the first place. So my book showcases the once predominant view that our rights are not to be asserted kind of willy-nilly according to our will or desires as they tend to be thought of today. Rather, rights are, properly speaking, born of and enable us to fulfill our already existing responsibilities to God, to ourselves, to our family, and to our communities.
There is this idea in our culture, Erika, that we as women have this fundamental right to end a child's life because that child is in our womb. Of course, we as Catholics, we reject that. But Erika, where did that idea of abortion as a right originate?
Well, the short answer is, of course, seven men in black robes in Roe v. Wade. The long answer is a very long one indeed, and it's given much attention in my book. But I think for simplicity's sake, you could say it was the conflation of several factors. So one, the rising expectation that was born of the pill in the late 1960s that we could really kind of totally control reproduction. And number two, really powerful concerns about population control, some of which, as we now know, are strongly eugenic. And I think the third is really the growing prevalence of a kind of property rights philosophy or ethos applied to human beings. But I think it's really important to note that the arguments that got us Roe v. Wade were not pro-woman ones. And actually, I've just had the opportunity to co-author an amicus brief on behalf of more than 200 women, professionals, and scholars urging the Supreme Court to overturn Roe in its review of a Mississippi abortion law in Dobbs v. Jackson this fall.
That's incredible. You know, Erika, I'm curious to ask you this question. As a Catholic woman yourself, what's your response when you hear that common line that it's my body, my choice?
Well, my first response is my choice to do what? This kind of tagline is really, I think, born of a deeply, I guess you'd say, impoverished view of choice or freedom that really neglects to ask about the content of our choice, and so really holds up choice itself as its own end. And so just to really make it simple, I mean, don't we even teach children that before they go to choose something, they need to ask themselves, is this thing I desire to do choice-worthy at all? Is it good and so worth choosing, or is it evil and so to be avoided? It's really impossible to talk about choice or freedom without talking about, you know, what it aims toward its end.
It's a really good point. You know, speaking of feminism and the feminist movement, we do see, I think, today, especially with millennials and the Gen Z age groups, women who identify as pro-life feminists. Erika, is there room, in your opinion, in the feminist movement today for pro-life women, and do you see a shift happening?
Well, I'd say in the feminist movement, no, there's no room for pro-lifers at all. But I actually think that feminism, kind of the feminism of our time, has been really deeply corrupted by abortion, and so is kind of eating away at itself. And so the evident failures of modern feminism have, I think, opened a space for something new and a new and better way to think about rights, women's rights, and our shared responsibilities to one another. So that's what I kind of try to offer in my new book.
Well, thank you so much for all your thoughtfulness and the work you put into this. Erika Bachiochi, author of The Rights of Women, Reclaiming a Lost Vision. Thank you.
Thank you, Catherine.
Coming up, Marie Claire magazine claims we need to see more abortions in film and on TV. I speak out next. Plus, we're joined by an OBGYN and NaProTechnology surgeon as we commemorate Natural Family Planning Awareness Week. She tells us the medical benefits of practicing NFP. Welcome back to EWTN Pro-Life Weekly. I'm Catherine Hadro. A global fashion magazine is pushing for more abortion portrayals in films and on TV. That is this week's Speak Out segment. Marie Claire magazine recently featured an article by a pro-abortion writer, Danielle Campamore, who argued that we need to see more characters who are parents in film and television having abortions. The article, titled "We Need to See More Parents Having Abortions in Film and Television," bemoaned the fact that most abortion portrayals are about young women who don't want to become parents, instead of showing parents getting abortions. She conceded there has been a large increase of abortions in films, 12 in 2020, a huge jump from 3 in 2019, but the Marie Claire article argued there needs to be more abortion portrayals and they need to be of parents and include more diverse storylines. She also downplayed the seriousness of the abortion procedure, writing, quote, "Television shows and movies depend on drama and conflict. The reality of abortion care is that most people are not conflicted about their decision, and the procedure, be it a surgical abortion or a medication abortion, is incredibly safe and quick. This writer thinks we need to see more abortion representation to show just how ordinary it is. But there is nothing ordinary about abortion. There is nothing ordinary about a mother ending the life of her own child. We cannot ever normalize abortion because abortion is not normal. Claiming there needs to be more abortions on screen is the same as saying we need to see more death and more violence on screen. We need the opposite. We need to see more storylines of heroic women and families embracing life, of overcoming any challenges they have, and of ultimately discovering how strong they are. Our media doesn't need to show any more harm on the television or movie theater screen. We need messages with more empowerment and love and truth.
The physician's recommended treatment plan should be based on clinical experience as well as scientific evidence.
That's a glimpse of Dr. Naomi Whittaker's Instagram page. Dr. Whittaker is a Catholic OBGYN and NaProTechnology surgeon who frequently shares the benefits of natural family planning methods on her social media page. For this week's Pro-Life Focus, we are delving into NFP as it is Natural Family Planning Awareness Week. It falls on the 53rd anniversary of St. Paul VI's encyclical Humanae Vitae, which reaffirmed the Catholic Church's teaching against contraception. Natural family planning, or NFP, is a broad term for a variety of methods based on observing the naturally occurring signs and symptoms of a woman's fertile and infertile phases of her cycle. No drugs, devices, or surgeries are ever used to avoid pregnancy with NFP. And joining us now on Skype is Dr. Naomi Whittaker, an OBGYN, NaProTechnology surgeon, and fertility care instructor. Dr. Whittaker, welcome to the show. During this NFP Awareness Week, can you first speak strictly from a medical perspective on what you see as the medical advantage to couples embracing natural family planning?
Absolutely. So natural family planning is basically empowering women and couples with the knowledge of their fertility and their cycle. So this knowledge is extremely valuable. It can be used in multiple ways. So using first natural family planning, you think of avoiding pregnancy and using this instead of birth control methods or devices that carry with it risks and side effects. And also it adds a whole nother array of things that you can use it for, including you can turn it around. It's flexible to be able to use it to achieve pregnancy, not just avoid pregnancy. So it's totally unique in its aspect to be able to use it for achieving pregnancy. And so it's flexible, and a couple can decide on any given day what they want to use it for, which is completely unique. In addition, this information can be used to monitor health. A woman's educated on what's normal, what's abnormal, and how to plot this down, this data scientifically and standard in a standard way to understand what's going on. And so they can monitor what's going on. And when she sees something's abnormal, she's able to bring this information to a doctor, be proactive, get treatment, to work cooperatively with this cycle using that NFP data.
That really is such a gift. I mentioned that you are a NaProTechnology surgeon. What does that mean exactly, and how does it rely upon NFP?
Sure. So as a NaProTechnology surgeon, I'm trained to interpret this NFP data that women collect, and I use this to understand women's health issues. And sometimes the treatment does include surgery. NaProTechnology surgery treats the underlying condition to restore health instead of masking symptoms with birth control, for example. And so some things we do are quite unique and complex. And you can think of this as plastic surgery of the pelvis.
Wow, that's incredible. And I think that key there is restoring fertility. I'm curious, Dr. Whittaker, how did you yourself get to be so passionate about natural family planning and fertility?
Sure. So there's a long story behind it, but I'll try to keep it brief as far as basically I learned the hard way. When I was young, I had shame and resentment of my cycles and fertility, and I ended up on the pill. And everything changed when I learned about natural family planning. And the science is really what
brought me into this and opened my eyes to the beauty of fertility. And God timed this in a pivotal moment in my life when I was in the middle of medical school, and it changed my entire career path to pursue NaProTechnology. And I wanted to do that to give the incredible gift of fertility appreciation and healing to women to empower them. And this coincided with my path to becoming a mother. Mm-hmm. And then my becoming a mother led me to become even more passionate to help give that gift of motherhood to other women.
Mm. Well, and I know, and I've heard from people personally how much they've benefited from what you do as a doctor. Dr. Whittaker, I understand that you are Catholic. It seems to me the Catholic Church's embrace of NFP is truly what empowers women's healthcare. Can you speak to that?
Yeah, my NFP patients often know more about the menstrual cycle than many doctors. Mm. And I do see a big difference between my patients who chart and those who don't. We're able to really understand their menstrual cycle and what's going on quite quickly and base a treatment plan that works with their cycle. I can offer even more treatment options for them if they're able to chart. But also many women use that information and don't need a doctor. They don't need a doctor to prescribe them medications to help them, you know, avoid pregnancy, or, you know, or they may be able to avoid, you know, many other types of invasive procedures like IVF and achieving pregnancy, even with charting alone. By using that chart, they can see red flags as well and come seek a NaPro doctor to be proactive. They can find their issues early and see a NaPro doctor early to treat women's health issues.
That's incredible. It's that self-knowledge that is such a gift, and I think that's what is so empowering, and I'm just so grateful for your work. We need like 50 more of you. So thank you so much, Dr. Naomi Whittaker. God bless you.
Thank you. God bless.
That does it for this edition of EWTN Pro-Life Weekly. Until next time, we'd love to hear from you. Find us on social media at EWTN Pro-Life on all social media platforms, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. We're there. You can also send us a message by emailing prolifeweekly@ewtn.com. We love to hear from you. Remember, life is a gift. Your life is a gift. God bless.